Normalmente aquí hay mucho menos gente, ¿no? Que en YouTube, ¿no? No te oigo. I'm going to write my students to get inside the Zoom instead of the... Sí, pero les voy a escribir. Okay. Okay. So thank you very much. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming. Today I have the pleasure of having Antonio Politi. And I would like, first of all, to thank him for accepting this invitation to talk in our colloquium in the Institute of Physics at UNAM. And I want to say, I want to read some biographical data about his career. So he graduated in physics with a thesis on optical instability. And now he has the sixth century chair at the University of Aberdeen since 2011. And he's a fellow of the American Physical Society. He's a fellow of the Institute of Physics. He's a Gutweiler fellow. He was a recipient of the Senior Humboldt Prize. And he has been associate editor of the Physical Review A since 1998, and he's very well known because he, on the field, because he has two books, on one on complexity and another one on Lyapunov exponents, which are very well known, these two books. And he has been, he's the author of more than 200 papers in peer-reviewed journals. He has an H factor of 55, more than 10,000 citations. And I would like to say that he's very well known because he, in many different areas like for example, in thermal transport, he has a very well known review of thermal transport in two dimensions when he speaks about the importance of non-linearity and that kind of things. He's also very well known for his work in dynamical systems. But especially during the last year, he has been tackling a very important problem, which is related with the formations of patterns produced by neurons that are fired. So I think he's going to talk about this today. So thank you very much again, Antonio, for accepting to give a talk.
Okay, thank you for the very kind invitation. As the title says, I'm going to talk about collective dynamics in networks of nonlinear oscillators. I have inserted neurons in brackets because I'm, say, honestly talking of nonlinear oscillators, and some of these oscillators are meant to describe in a, say, in a simplified way the behavior of neurons. So the hope is that what I'm going to explain today is of some relevance also to understand the behavior of the irregular dynamics which emerges in the mammalian brain. Okay, so, just a moment, why I'm not... So that's a very, very general outline. I'm first of all going to introduce the concept of collective dynamics. I feel this is necessary because very often when you hear seminars about collective dynamics, it is generically meant the fact that when you put together many units and you look at the behavior which is coming out of this ensemble of oscillators is very different from the behavior of the single units. And this is identified as collective dynamics. Instead, for me, collective dynamics is to be meant like in statistical mechanics, when you look at the behavior of an ensemble of objects, typically molecules, atoms, and then you see that collectively speaking, there are properties which change and maybe there are phase transitions. I will, I mean, be more specific in a moment. And I'm going to introduce some old results in simple mean field models to illustrate what is really meant by me for this kind of collective behavior. And then I discuss several setups. I will see how many of them I am able to discuss. The reason is that there is not yet at all a generic theory that can describe and predict a priori what kind of behavior you expect in different conditions. I'm also sure that I can anticipate that I will not be able to touch all possible setups that are currently investigated in the literature because there are too many of them. So I am somehow selecting on the basis of what is my goal. And my goal is to illustrate behavior of this ensemble of oscillators, both from the microscopic point of view and from the macroscopic point of view. So that's the story. Now let's go. And in this first slide, I'm really willing to explain what I mean. I'm just in this picture drawing the evolution of a signal obtained by averaging over a certain number. In one case, so the green curve is just an irregular signal. It doesn't matter which way I have generated it. Then I can generate 10 of them independent of one another. I take the average as it is defined over here. And in fact, you see that the fluctuations of the average over 10 signals is much are much smaller, and things go down if you take 100 then 1,000, and that's exactly what I mean in the sense that in this case obviously there is no any collective dynamics, in the sense that if you in principle take not 1,000 but an infinite number of signals and you average, and if they are uncorrelated with one another, you just get completely flat signal. So, and that's what I don't want, what I'm not interested in. I'm interested in instead in signals that are arising from different oscillators. You average over them. In principle, you are not sure whether they are correlated or not, and you discover that looking at the average, the evolution of the average is irregular and high in a sense, showing you that there is some hidden coherence, or if you want, some evidence of synchronization, which sometimes is not expected. Okay, the collective dynamics is an issue which is behind my talk. The other issue is the networks. I will typically consider very simple setup. One, the simplest is all-to-all coupling, the mean field type of coupling. So each oscillator is going to be coupled with any other oscillator in the same way. This is simple.
Just one question, Antonio.
Yes.
Are you changing the transparencies or not?
I have changed the
No, because it didn't change in the.
So you still you don't see the I see exactly. The network. Oh, that's okay. The only I can try the following. I don't go full screen, and I let's see if just a minute. Okay, now
okay.
What
do yeah.
Do you see the network?
See yeah. Exactly.
Okay. So let's hope it's less pleasant, but should still be visible. I hope. Okay, so now the picture itself is not terribly crucial, but nevertheless, what I want to say is that I'm going to consider networks. The simplest network which I'm going to consider is where all oscillators are coupled with all the other in the same way. All the oscillators are identical, and the reason is that when one is dealing with mean field coupling, there is it's much easier to develop an underlying theory, and so you can sort of better understand what is going on, even though obviously these are special networks. Otherwise, there is an important difference I want to clarify, because you will hear again this difference in the following. There are two classes of networks I'm considering, sparsely or massively coupled. The sparse networks are those where on average, each say oscillator, each neuron is coupled to k neurons, other neurons or oscillators, and the k is kept fixed while the number of oscillators is let diverge to infinity. So this is sparse. Otherwise, one can consider also massive coupling. So you consider the limit where n, the number of oscillators, is going to infinity. And this limit is always necessary from a mathematical point of view, because you want to define in a mathematical way, in a mathematical precise way, what is going to happen exactly as in happens in statistical mechanics. And this second limit is massive, meaning that you consider k proportional to n, so you let k over n be finite. And the extreme case of massive coupling is the one I was mentioning, mean field, all to all. So, and other than that, I'm always assuming an Erdős-Rényi structure, meaning that the connections are randomly selected. So I'm not going to consider any of these fancy networks where there is a fractal structure. So it's just as basic as possible. And the reason is that even in these relatively simple networks, the theory of the dynamical behavior is still to be fully explained. So that's the reason. Okay, now another important difference, which is also often encountered when you study or when you read the papers devoted to coupled oscillator, there are two coupling schemes. One is called average driven, and essentially it's based on the idea that each coupling term, so here is the sum, so that I'm referring to a generic oscillator called I, labeled I, and this sum is the sum of the contribution due to the coupling with all other oscillators. Here I'm assuming n, but I mean it should be k. Actually, I have to say this is really an error. So this capital N should be replaced by K. So in this type of coupling, you assume that the coupling term has a specific sign. So you average K elements. And if you are interested in a limit where this coupling term is not is not going to diverge, it keeps an importance of the same size as the local dynamics characterized by the variable f, you need to divide by k. Inside, I repeat, the reason for this scaling is in such a way that you keep the two terms of the same order, even in the limit when k is very large. But there is another type of coupling, which is often considered in neuroscience, and the following one. In this case, you assume that on average, G, the coupling term, is zero. So when you sum terms which are on average zero, I mean, you expect that this coupling term to be of the order of square root of the number of terms. And then in order to again ensure the fact that the local and the, say the coupling term are of the same order for K large, you have to consider square root of K in the normalization. So these are two schemes, and they have been explored in different contexts, and it's important to be aware that they have some relevance. And now let me come to an old result. In a sense, it deals with a very artificial model, but it's important for me to give you an idea of what I mean for a collective non-trivial dynamics. It is based on logistic maps. And it's a mean field model of logistic maps. All of them are identical. So if you look at this equation here, and for a moment you forget about this last term, and you essentially recognize that this is the logistic map if F is chosen to be this parabola that you see here on the left. And G is meant to be the coupling. Now the coupling is via this variable H, which is defined here. So in practice, what I have here, I have n maps. Each of them is evolving according to the rule of the logistic equation, which means chaotic if the parameter of the map is such that the dynamic is chaotic. And you sum all of them, and that's it. So, and in principle, you want to consider n very, very large. I mean, I think Kaneko went even to 1 million and so on and so on. So, what does it happen to the variable h when n is extremely large? And here is a return plot of the variable h, where I repeat, h you see here is the sum over very, very many values, so of 1 million, even more, of maps. And the way it evolves in time is identified by this picture here, where this blurring effect is not any effect due to statistical fluctuation, is there. And it is a manifestation of the fact that the global dynamics of this ensemble of maps is irregular itself. So the average fluctuates, and initially it was even considered as a sort of contradiction with the theorem, the central limit theorem, because the single maps are known to be chaotic, so you tend to believe that they are independent of one another. So if you sum 1 million different signals that are independent, then obviously the statistical fluctuations are almost negligible, and you should expect something that is constant. And the fact that there was a complete surprise at that time, now it's much more understood, is the fact that there are hidden correlations which are emerging from the evolution of the model. And that's, if you want, the first example of collective dynamics I want to address today. So this was the first model, and one could argue, okay, that's a very special model, because after all, logistic maps are more or less a sort of toy example of chaos rather than something that comes in physically realistic models. But then a few years later, a more, say, realistic examples came out, coupling continuous time system, first of all, and these systems were the so-called Stewart-Landau oscillator. Why Stewart-Landau oscillators are more, say, physically relevant? Because the Stewart-Landau equation, which is reported here, I mean, if you forget the last term, which is the coupling, this is the normal form of the Hopf bifurcation. So if you have any nonlinear system which at some point undergoes a Hopf bifurcation and starts oscillating in a regular way, then you know that you can always rephrase this nonlinear system, at least in the vicinity of the bifurcation, and describe by this cubic equation, which is also named Stewart-Landau. What independently Nakagawa in Kuramoto in Japan and Haim Rappel in France did was to study this setup where, I mean, okay, this term here is a sort of, I mean, is a parameter, forget about it, it's just a number. And W is the coupling, which is essentially the same type of coupling that you have seen in the logistic maps. It's just you sum the variable W. You have only to take into account that the W now is a complex variable. So it has a real and an imaginary part. And so that's the coupling, a simple linear coupling. You want to consider n very large. Here it was, this is the result of a simulation made for n equal to 2048. And this is a snapshot of the position of the W, the real and the imaginary part, after, say, some time. And then you see that the phases are distributed in this structure. And what is more interesting is this picture here, this is a snapshot of the distribution of the variables W is changing over time. So this is what you see at some time. At some later time, you will see something different. And that's, I mean, just the manifestation, as I said, in this more realistic system, mean field still identical oscillators, but they have the spontaneous emergence of collective dynamics. And also in this case, let me anticipate, hopefully I will have the time to return to this issue, the evolution of the single oscillators is also chaotic in the in this case, as in the previous example. Now, I want to add a third example, which is not as, say, okay, which is still in the same spirit, but in this case, the collective dynamics is not going to be, say, chaotic as it is in the other case. Nevertheless, it's non-trivial. And it's interesting because this is a dynamical behavior observed in a model which is very much used in neuroscience. It's called LIF, leaky, integrated, and fire. The dynamic is described is essentially by these two equations. The first equation is a relaxation, is a linear relaxation. So that's the V is to be interpreted as the membrane potential of the single neuron, and it evolves in trying to relax, but it's also forced by a field. And this field is the, if you want, the sum of all the fields emitted by all the other neurons that are in contact with our reference neuron. Again, I am working in a model of fully coupled, so you don't have to care about the structure of the coupling of the network. And the reason why, so the equation that is satisfied by the field E is linear and maybe looks complicated, but physically it has a very simple meaning. It's the mathematical way of saying that each neuron emits a spike of with the shape that you see here. That's the shape of a single pulse, and you have to sum all of them. And in order, the best mathematical way to describe how the field generated by summing pulses emitted whenever some of these neurons, each of these neurons is reaching a specific threshold. This is something I forgot to say, because what the neuron does is relaxes. At some point reaches the threshold, it emits a spike, and then the potential, the membrane potential is reset to a value here assumed to be zero, and it goes on again and again. So that's the scheme. All neurons are equal to one another. And the transition that Van Beswijk detected was the following one, which is, so if you change, alpha is essentially the inverse of the width of the pulse. So this pulse has a shape here, and the inverse width is alpha. And here G is instead the coupling strength. In the blue area here, the behavior for n very large is just called display state, means that the field is constant. So nothing interesting from the point of view of collective dynamics. But if you are in this, say, yellow region, the white region, that you start observing a collective dynamics because the total field, so you sum up all the fields emitted by all the spikes, start oscillating in a periodic way. So it, this is spontaneously emerging by itself. And this type of behavior is not so trivial for one reason that I don't have the time to discuss the details here, but it's important that you are aware that the behavior of the total field, which I repeat, is the sum of the pulses emitted by all the neurons, is periodic. But if you were to monitor the behavior of each single neuron, you would discover that the behavior of each single neuron is quasi-periodic. So it's the mixture of two frequencies, one which is the collective frequency, and the other is the frequency of the single neuron, which essentially tells how much time is needed for the neuron to reach the threshold once it has been reset. So is non-trivial for one reason, because normally when you hear about quasi-periodicity, quasi-periodicity in nonlinear dynamics is very fragile phenomenon. If you you can have a quasi-periodic behavior, you tune a parameter, and normally you get something which is suddenly a locked state. So the two frequencies which are incommensurate with one another, then suddenly they change and then become very much locked in the sense the ratio corresponds to a specific, it's a rational number. This doesn't happen here, and for reasons that are not even entirely understood. Anyhow, that's the third example of collective dynamics that emerges in a network of fully coupled oscillators. So just to summarize, something which is I consider as a sort of beginning of the theory, not yet the theory. I mean, I have discussed three examples. The first example, the maps, are maps which behave chaotically because the logistic map is chaotic, and the collective dynamics is also chaotic. Then I have shown the Stewart-Landau oscillators. The single unit the single unit without forcing behave periodically, because in the case of the Stewart-Landau oscillator, they describe a pure rotation. But what we already know since many years, that if you have an oscillator which is can behave periodically, which satisfies a second order differential equation, and you subject this oscillator to a periodic forcing, it can become chaotic. So even in the case of Stewart-Landau oscillator, they can behave chaotically. And the interesting point is that also in the case of Stewart-Landau oscillator, I have not given any evidence, but you should believe me, that the collective chaos, there is collective chaos. Finally, instead, in the third example, we are dealing with one-dimensional ordinary differential equation with only one variable, which is the membrane potential. And in this case, the collective dynamics is strictly periodic, so it's not chaotic. And so this, in fact, raises the question of under which condition the behavior, which is the collective behavior, is chaotic, knowing what are the properties of the single units. And there is not yet a rigorous answer to this question. Okay, now something to sort of explain what kind of dynamics one should look at in the case of these mean field models. I'm doing this, I'm explaining the point with reference to discrete maps because it's easier, but the concept are the same. So at the level with these mean field models, at the level of maps are described an equation of this type. So capital U is the local variable describing the single units. A single unit, yes, and you see that it depends on the variable at the previous time, and it depends on this angular bracket denote the average of U. So you, in principle, have, I don't know, 1,000 units. You let them evolve. At each time, you determine the average, the mean field, and so essentially it is a one-dimensional map where one parameter is self-determined. And that's the behavior that you have to, the type of model you have to let evolve. Now, let's give a look at this system, but from a macroscopic point of view. From the macroscopic point of view, in principle, you assume that you have infinitely many oscillators. And so what you are interested in is the probability distribution of the variable U at any time. So in the case of simple maps, forgetting about the existence of a coupling, you have just to write what is the well-known Frobenius-Poisson operator, which is a linear operator, which describes how the probability is evolving. So for a moment, keep forgetting about this coupling here. So the Frobenius-Poisson operator, it tells you how the probability distributed at time n plus one comes out from the probability at the previous time. You have to look at the pre-images of the variable U, and here in the denominator, you have just to insert the Jacobian of the transformation, and there is the sum here, because in general, these are maps that are non-invertible, so there are more than one pre-image for each value of the variable itself. And this operator is linear if, I repeat, you don't consider this fact here, because it's just, this is an equation for the variable p, is a function, but p is the variable, and it's in the right-hand side, the sum of terms where p is just appearing here, so it's strictly linear. But the equation does, is no longer linear if you include the, say, the self-consistency condition due to the fact that this parameter here is defined as I'm reporting here. So the average value, definition of an average, is via the distribution P itself. So P is hidden here whenever you are dealing with a self-consistent equation. So this is an equation which is now non-linear. It's an equation, it's a functional equation, because it's an equation for a probability. It's a functional equation, so it's an equation which operates in an infinite dimensional space. It's a non-linear, and you can certainly expect for a non-linear equation in infinite dimensional space to exhibit some chaotic behavior. But this is the chaotic behavior of the probability distribution. It's not the chaotic behavior of the single units. So that's the important point I hope I am just able to convey. Okay, now another issue, because I'm going to touch in the various examples I'm discussing, I'm considering two classes, another way of classifying networks. Most of them are homogeneous, but sometimes it's important to consider heterogeneous. What does it mean? Homogeneous is, I mean, that all the oscillators are identical and all the coupling in all pairs of oscillators is the same. So these are homogeneous networks. Sometimes I'm going to consider heterogeneous networks, meaning that either the single oscillators are slightly different or even significantly different from one another, and or the network structure is different, in the sense that the coupling in between pairs of different oscillators is different. And that's important because you will see in a few minutes that depending whether you are dealing with the heterogeneous or instead of homogeneous oscillators, you may have a higher degrees of complexity at the collective level. Okay, now talking of nonlinear, nonlinear oscillator, talking of collective dynamics, it's unavoidable to mention the Kuramoto model. This is still a much studied model, and some variants of the Kuramoto model are being studied still by many scientists. What the model is, and then what kind of behavior, and how important is in connection to my goal today. So the model is described by this equation here. So each is a model, you have oscillators. Omega I is the natural frequency of each oscillator, and if they omega I are different from one another, this is which is the typical setup. We are in the presence of heterogeneous network, but this part is a standard. This is mean field. So we assume that each oscillator is coupled with all the other oscillators. The coupling is only is via the phase difference, and G measures the strength of the coupling. And finally, sometimes you want to add some noise which is acting on the different oscillators in a different way. So, and what kind of behavior you expect, how to quantify the behavior in this type of network of mean field model is via the so-called Kuramoto ordered parameter. So for each oscillator, to each oscillator, depending on the current value of the phase, you attach an arrow of unit length, and then you sum all these arrows and you divide by n. And here in these two pictures, I am just schematizing two examples. One where the phases are more or less uniformly distributed, and then as a result, you end up with an arrow which is very small modulus. Or you might have an example like this, and that's an example of synchronization. So this is to say what? To say that once you have all the phases and you determine this parameter here, the amplitude, the modulus, if it is large, say if it is even exactly one, you have perfect synchronization. If instead it is nearly zero, this means there is no synchronization. And in fact, this model is famous because of the transition, depending on the strength of the parameter in the limit of n going to infinity, the modulus of the order parameter is either strictly zero or it grows from zero and it can even approach one depending on the way the frequencies are distributed. So that's a typical model which is used to describe synchronization. From my point of view, I don't consider this extremely, say, interesting, because whenever you are in a synchronized regime, it happens that that the modulus of R stays constant and you just have a rotation. So the highest degree of complexity that you can observe in this model is just an order parameter, which is different from zero, but is just constant. Nevertheless, okay, now I want to show that working with leak integrated and fire neurons, and adopting a setup which is very similar to the Kuramoto, except now the mode dynamics is different, is that of the leak integrated and fire, you can have a transition which is much more interesting. So what is the model? The model is, forgetting for a moment the coupling, is here, when AI means that each oscillator is characterized by a different frequency, because A in practice is a parameter which identifies the frequency of the oscillator. So if you forget, if you negate this term, this is the evolution of an oscillator which periodically reaches the threshold, is reset to zero, and depending on the value of AI, it is characterized by different periodicity. Now you insert this in a setup where this mean field coupling, so all neurons are coupled with all the other neurons, and with delta means that now the spikes that are emitted are delta pulses, are no longer these smooth pulses I was illustrating before, and this TD also means that there is a delay in the received time from the sending time. And what happens when you increase the coupling strength? So it's this bifurcation diagram, in a sense, should be similar to the one of the Kuramoto model, except that instead of dealing with the Kuramoto type oscillators, these are leak integrated and fires. This is another way of quantifying the amplitude of the collective dynamics, essentially, is the standard deviation of the field. I mean, if the coupling is very small, I mean, in practice, you sum all the fields emitted by all the neurons, they are emitted essentially at different times. And if you take n extremely large, in practice, the fluctuations of the field are very negligible. And in fact, you can see here that if you compare the red, the black, and the green curve, which by the way correspond to to number of oscillators which increases each time it doubles, you see that the amplitude of fluctuations go to zero exactly as you expect according to statistical fluctuations. But there is a transition point, a critical point above which you start having oscillations of the field, and these kind of oscillations are represented there. So you see that above the criticality, the field, the total field, this is the sum of all the fields emitted by the neurons. In some sense, you could interpret this as the signal that you measure in an electroencephalogram. And what is remarkable is that the field oscillates in an irregular way. I mean, that's a simple way. Okay, this doesn't prove anything, but it's just to illustrate that whenever you are above the threshold, the collective dynamics is not as simple as the one of the Kuramoto model, but it is collectively chaotic in a way that has not been yet fully understood. Now here, I don't want to go too much into detail. It's just another example of a model where I have changed the structure of the oscillators to see to what extent the neuronal model adopted earlier is special or not. And so the only message that it's important for you is that if you modify the evolution of the single oscillators in some way, I mean, this phenomenology that is reported here is kept. And this is to say that this result is not too special. I mean, okay, now, okay, that's in fact the phase diagram obtained in this second type of model, where again, you only need to see that up to some critical value, there is no interesting dynamics, the field is constant. Yeah, in this case, you can even, we are even able to measure the Kuramoto order parameter, and this is zero. And then at some point it becomes larger than zero, and a variance with the Kuramoto model is not only constant, but R fluctuates in time. And in fact, here it's an example for one parameter, for the parameter G1.3, so it's significantly above threshold. Let's just, I mean, 1.3, it's about here, so it's significantly above threshold. And here is the modulus of the Kuramoto order parameter, and you see it's far from constant, it fluctuates in a very irregular way, so meaning that the collective dynamics is really significantly irregular. And what is also interesting is to verify that this type of irregularity is not the consequence of statistical fluctuations. You can just focus on the first panel where I am reporting the power spectrum of the signal R of T. So R is, I repeat, the Kuramoto order parameter. I compute the Fourier power spectrum for three different network sizes, 4,000, 16,000, and 64,000. And you can hardly recognize who is who, meaning that this sort of, say, relatively broadband spectrum remains as such when you increase even from 4 to 64, so even by 16 times the number of oscillators. So these fluctuations, this broad, the width of these peaks is really there, is not the consequence of having worked with a few oscillators. So there are no statistical fluctuations. Okay, now I want to go to another setup. Initially, I was mentioning there are two types of coupling. So far, I have focused myself only on mean field, sorry, not only mean field, but important fluctuation driven, mean driven. All the models were mean driven. And in fact, in all models you have seen so far, the coupling was containing a 1 over n here in the denominator. Now I want to introduce an example with the square root of n, because this is often considered as more important in the context of neuroscience, reason being that in the brain there are inhibitory and excitatory connections. And even though the fraction of inhibitory connection is, say, much larger than the excitatory ones, or vice versa, sorry, at this point, but the two fractions are completely different. Nevertheless, the strength of the two phenomena altogether are comparable. And we don't know if this is the consequence of natural selection, or it's the consequence of mechanism which force the system to have a similar weight for the excitation and inhibition. So the consequence is that in this community is often considered a type of coupling where there is a square root of n. And now I want to quote an example which is certainly well known to in statistical mechanics. I'm starting from equilibrium statistical mechanics, and the Hopfield model was introduced say long ago, but having in mind the spin glasses, and the problem approached from a dynamical point of view. So the model is of this type here. I mean, now H is the variable, which in the context of neural dynamics, you can interpret as the membrane potential. And then you can also interpret the hyperbolic tangent, which is a variable which goes from -1 to 1, and as an activity, and distinguishing a value which is close to -1 as the inactive neuron, or close to 1 active neuron. And so the model is here. So there is some relaxation, gamma measures the strength of the relaxation, G is the coupling. GIJ now is the coupling, the strength of the coupling from neuron I to neuron J, or spin I to spin J, if you want. And then here there is some noise, forget it for a moment. And these GIJ are typically chosen at random. So this is an example of heterogeneous networks. But in the context of the Hopfield model, since he was interested in describing equilibrium statistical problems, he was assuming that Jij is symmetric, meaning that the value of Jij is random, but always equal to J, capital J, J. So if you exchange the two in subindex, the corresponding coupling is always the same. Essentially, this is important because it ensures the satisfaction of detailed balance. And as a consequence, you always have in this model, under this constraint, convergence to steady state. So dynamically speaking, is not interesting. It was very, very interesting because in spite of the fact that it is converging to a steady state, you have, say, very many minima, and that was the interesting part, story of the spin glasses. In fact, depending on the initial condition, you may end up in one of the very many minima. Okay, but this was only for introductory reasons. Now, in starting from this model, Sompolinski long ago decided to study a variant of the model where just he dropped the condition on Jij. So the Jij from now on were assumed to be really random but fixed, so quenched noise, but no longer true that the if you exchange the two indices here, you get the same value. And in this model, he discovered that there was a phase transition. Okay, let's phase transition, maybe it's described over here, just, okay, let me jump over here. So if you increase, if you increase the coupling strength below a certain value, the H variable converge to a fixed point, which is different from the different oscillators, but they don't change over time. So, and that's, if you want, stationary solution up to some critical value. But above a critical value, they discover that there is some dynamics. And this dynamics is a strictly microscopic chaos. So in this type of model, which was the first one where using this type of, coupling scheme with the square root of n, they discover that above a certain critical value, the microscopic dynamics is chaotic. But from the point of view I want to address today, meaning I'm interested in collective dynamics, averaging over the behavior of all oscillators, of all neurons, nothing interesting. I mean, you schematize over here, QC is the average of all values of all variables, all oscillators, and it changes with G, but if you plot the dependence of QE on time, everywhere for any value of G is always constant. So in this model, which is interesting in some respect, is not so interesting from the point of view of collective dynamics. Nevertheless, it's an interesting model because you can observe the onset of microscopic chaos. So, maybe this I can skip and I want to go on because I would like to mention a few other issues. Now, let me return to the leaky integrated and fire neurons. Now you see I am I have introduced the square root of n. And the reason being that even if it's sort of hidden in this model, model introduced by Brunel already 20 years ago, there are two families of neurons which all follow the same dynamics, but a certain fraction of them is assumed to be excitatory and a certain fraction is assumed to be inhibitory. And the two fractions and the strength of the coupling are chosen a priori such that on average you expect that the strength of the coupling is zero. So when you sum n of such signals, you expect, because of statistical fluctuation, this sum to be of order square root of n. And if it is balanced in by the square root of n, you expect that this coupling is of the same order of the local evolution. And in fact, even though Brunel developed a formalism to describe the behavior of this system, and he didn't notice this, but much later, we discovered that running exactly the same simulations that they defined much earlier, we discovered that in this system, there is an example of collective dynamics and is can be easily appreciated by looking at these three snapshots. So what I'm doing here is reporting the instantaneous values of the membrane potential. So imagine I'm running simulation for 4,000 oscillators under this scheme here. And now at any time step, a specific time step, I look at the distribution of the membrane potential. And these three curves correspond to the distribution at three different times. And you see that they are significantly different from one another. So there are fluctuations, collective fluctuations. And in other words, this model is able to exhibit some collective dynamics. And in a more quantitative way, this is a typical indicator that is used while in the community of people interested in quantifying the degree of synchronization. You just look at the fluctuation of the global quantity divided by the fluctuations of the variable on the single variable. So this indicator is equal to zero if all the oscillators are independent of one another, or is equal to one if all neurons oscillate perfectly in phase with one another. And so it's it's a number which is normalized between zero and one. And what I want just to show to you is, okay, these numbers are significantly larger than zero. And you see that I'm comparing the behavior of this order parameter, because it is an order parameter, for different network size from 10,000 to even above half a million. And you even see that the degree of collective dynamics even increases. But what is important is to show to you that even in this case, there is a collective dynamics, and it's irregular also in this case. Okay, now, maybe this I can skip. Oh, by the way, how much time still I have?
Let's say 10 minutes.
Because I wanted to discuss also this last simple model, because it's the only one where I can compare microscopic with macroscopic dynamics. So now I'm now jumping to a toy model, but it's a model which can be studied numerically in a relatively easy way. It's a toy model. It's essentially very similar to the initial model I was suggesting. I was recalling the one studied by Kaneko long ago. So instead of logistic maps, I'm dealing with Bernoulli maps. Bernoulli map is essentially a map where the variable, which is an angle, is multiplied by factor two. And in fact, you see here. And then it's mean field type of coupling. But the coupling here is not the usual linear coupling. It's more complicated. In this sense, it's not very realistic, but the message is not the importance of this model for me is not the fact that it's realistic or not. It allows studying the system both from the microscopic and the macroscopic point of view. So Z is the order parameter. So for each variable theta, I compute the cosine, the average of the cosine, I call it Z. And that's the evolution. That's the way the model is built. Here I'm reporting the snapshots, which is, if you want, is similar to what I was creating here. These are snapshots of the evolution at different times. And it is useful to show that there is something collective that is going on, even though obviously you cannot conclude if it is irregular or irregular, but surely there is something that is going on. And here is similar meaning. So these are the value of the parameter I have selected. These are the distribution of the angles theta. for I don't remember how many oscillators. And so the distributions, you see, it's different, even though not exceedingly different, but it's quantitatively different at different times. So there is something which is going on, collectively speaking. And a better way to understand whether or not this collective dynamics is irregular is just plotting the order parameter z at the time t plus one versus the order parameter at time t. You see that is a semi pseudo, not pseudo, it's fractal structure. And it looks chaotic. It's not the proof of anything, but it's really, and I repeat, that's the concept, that's the description at the macroscopic level. Now, here in this picture, it's I am just presenting the different way to describe the system. Microscopic, what is microscopic? Microscopic is the following. Imagine you have n oscillators. So the model is defined in an n-dimensional space. So you have 1,000 direction. If n is equal to 1,000, you have 1,000 Lyapunov exponent. And and then you can compute a 1,000 Lyapunov exponent. Once you are dealing with a high-dimensional system, it is normal to plot the Lyapunov exponent versus an index nu, which is just the number divided by the total number. So nu is a number, is a fraction of oscillator between 0 and 1. And as usual, the Lyapunov exponent has plotted from the largest to the smallest. And these distributions are obtained for different network sizes. And upon increasing the network size, this curve are tending to become flatter and flatter, and the dashed line represents the limit that we expect to be reached for n extremely large. But that's true not for all for the entire part of the spectrum. There are initially some, the first two Lyapunov exponents behave differently. I mean, what is important anyhow for me to explain is that in this picture at the microscopic level, you have infinitely many, or very many positive Lyapunov exponents, because you see the lowest part is 0.3 to 1. So there are very many directions that are unstable. And the quantification is, you can see the numbers by yourself. And now let's jump to the macroscopic spectrum. So the macroscopic spectrum is the spectrum that you obtained by looking at the evolution of the probability density. So in this model, you can define relatively easily the corresponding self-consistent Frobenius-Perron operator, which is an operator acting on a functional space, which means that you have infinitely many directions, but now it's just the Lyapunov exponents, or the model, sorry, the equations are non-linear, so you have to expect also infinitely many Lyapunov exponents. And these are the most important Lyapunov exponents that we have obtained by integrating the equation and expanding in Fourier modes, because it's the best way to describe what is going on. So the issue that I want to draw to your attention is that it's a completely different story. I mean, so we are discussing the same model here from the microscopic point of view. We find very large number of directions that are unstable. And the same model, if you look instead at from the point of view of the probability density, yes, it is chaotic. It's just, this picture is speaking by itself that the collective dynamics is chaotic, but this collective chaos is, if you want, much weaker than the microscopic chaos. There is only one macroscopic Lyapunov exponent is larger than zero. Already the second one is is more negative than the positive one. And so the two worlds are not so well connected. I mean, the connection between these two worlds is for me is still a relatively hot topic, at least something that I would like to understand in a better way. And I want to transfer some of the ideas that I have in mind. One is studying the same model, microscopical and macroscopical. So it would be nice to understand why, I mean, you have so different degrees of instability. So in principle, even when you study, so this is for logistic maps, it's for even a say simpler system, not, when you iterate the map, what you do at the microscopic level, you just look at the value of the variable U at any time, and it evolves in this way. And what do you do when you go and you try to describe the same system at the macroscopic level? You are interested not in the position of the single oscillator, but you are interested in the probability distribution of the position of all the maps at any time. And for instance, I'm just displaying here one picture that, I mean, from the picture itself, you cannot say which way has been obtained. I could tell you I have obtained this probability distribution at some time, having iterated the Frobenius-Perron operator of uncoupled maps, or I could tell you, which is indeed the case, that this map, this picture has been obtained by considering 10,000, as it is reported here, maps, letting them evolve for some time, and then ordering from the smallest to the largest position the instantaneous value of the variable U. And if I didn't tell you which way I have obtained this, it would be basically impossible to distinguish one from the other representation, because after all, the model is the same. And nevertheless, the degree of stability of the two representations is different, because you have different ways of reporting, representing and obtaining the Lyapunov exponents. So this story is should require in itself an entire seminar. I only want to display this picture and trying to illustrate what is going on. That here I have obtained this picture from a fully microscopic description, in the sense that I have considered a very large number of oscillators. Then I have introduced a perturbation of the position of all the oscillators, perturbation that is so small that should be described by the microscopic Lyapunov exponent. And then I am nevertheless measuring the distance, not in terms of distances between oscillators, but between the corresponding distribution. You should imagine that I look very carefully at the distribution that I obtain iterating the reference trajectory and the perturbed one, and I measure the distance between them. And this is what I'm reporting here. And you see here initially the distance grows exponential in a clean way, and this growth corresponds exactly to the microscopic chaos. What is remarkable is that then at some point, when the distances are still small, but not as small as they were here, we enter another regime where, notice this is logarithmic versus linear, there is an exponential growth, which is different from the previous one. And it turns out that when you play the game with coupled maps, where there is some collective chaos, this second part of the curve is really telling us some information which corresponds to the degree of instability at the macroscopic level. So not anything rigorous, is just evidence for me that you have the chance, even from the fully microscopic description, to extract information on the collective instability at the collective level, just in this area. But it's something which cannot be obtained by linear, because this is the linearization of the microscopic equation. This probably, hopefully, this is something to be better understood, should correspond to the linearization of the Frobenius-Perron type of behavior. So I am perfectly aware that sounds a little bit mysterious, but is something that at least I would like to mention, and a point which in my opinion is interesting and important is the question of when you deal with very many oscillators, you can look at these models from the point of view of the microscopic dynamics, you learn something, but you want to look sometimes at the collective behavior, you learn something else. And the question is, how are these two pictures connected to one another, to what extent you can pass from one to the other? And with this statement, I'm going to stop. And sorry for having been too late.
Thank you very much, Antonio. So we are going to open the session of questions. If there are any questions, please let me know. Questions? I don't know if there are some questions on YouTube. Okay. We have many. Rafael, do you want to make a question? Your microphone. Rafael, your microphone is closed.
Okay. Okay. Very, very nice. A very nice talk. Thank you. A long time ago, I was looking at the problem with neurons in the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And at that time, we are assuming that the circadian rhythm was produced by coupling many oscillators together. And that had a problem because it doesn't matter how you connect or you couple the oscillators in a simple way, in a simple network, the fundamental frequency, collective frequency of the oscillators goes down like the square root of n. And I wanted you to comment about that. If in these nonlinear neuron models, that doesn't happen.
I mean, okay, I don't know the model you have been working with, so I cannot comment on that. But from what you say, I can certainly state the following. When you deal with coupled oscillators, you have sometimes phenomena which tend to sort of disappear in, say, the so-called thermodynamic limit, so when n is going to infinity, and some other which persist. For instance, let me go back to this. This picture here, this picture is an evidence of some collective dynamics, not about frequencies, but this sometimes some evidence of collective dynamic which survives in the limit of n going to infinity. But I have to tell you that there are some tricks that I didn't have the time to mention, or say some peculiarity of the model that I have adopted. If I had changed the little bit the structure of the model that I was integrating here, I would have observed that this collective dynamics would tend to disappear, to vanish when n goes to infinity. Mm-hmm. This is for the amplitude, not for the frequency. I'm not surprised to discover that depending on the setup, on some properties of the model, sometimes you discover something which is there when, because the simulation are unavoidably done with finite n, maybe you discover sometimes that they tend to disappear and sometimes they don't. And in some sense, this is one of the most important questions, just making a guess on trying to understand under which conditions some phenomena survive and when they don't. And maybe, who knows, let me even say that, because I am a physicist and I know I'm from statistical mechanics, I like the limit n going to infinity, because this brings me into a setup where hopefully statements are rigorous, mathematically speaking, but the brain is not, the brain is made of very many neurons, but not infinitely many. The number of connections is very large, but not infinite large. So, I cannot exclude some phenomena like, for instance, the circadian rhythm that I have never personally studied, that is something which is really going to die, so the frequency going to decrease, even using the most realistic and meaningful model, because thermodynamic limit is not the limit where life is working.
Thank you very much. That is very enlightening. Yeah. One trick we did was to introduce a heterogeneous network in which the interactions vary hierarchically in order to maintain the collective behavior stable, independent of the number of oscillators. But that is another story. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, you're welcome.
We have only time for one more question. Denis, please go.
Hello, thanks, Antonio, for the talk. I had a question more related to the biological function that this network could perform. So you have talked basically on the spontaneous oscillation or collective dynamics. Is it possible to study what would be the response of these networks to external stimuli? For instance, for this simulation of the sensory system, for instance, or maybe for pattern recognition, or I don't know. Is it possible to see the function or the biological function related, for instance, to sensory activity, to the susceptibility of these networks to external stimuli?
That's the question I would like personally to address, and it's already a few years I would like to engage myself, because in the context of neuroscience is the most important concept, the most important question. And I, for instance, in these last few years, there are approaches based on reservoir computing, this kind of stuff, which are essentially motivated by the questions, the points you are raising. But this question have been essentially posed in the context of networks, not of, pulse-coupled oscillators, which is exactly the way the brain works, but it's very much artificial neural networks, where the single units are considered just as, spins, 0, 1. And very few have started to address this question of how the brain is, generally speaking, computing, recognizing things, but having in mind more realistic for me, I mean pulse coupled, because it's obvious that the neurons send pulses. Maybe these systems that I'm considering as too simple, but nevertheless are much more meaningful than those that are schematized as spins. And there is very little, but my hope is that people is increasingly attracted by this question. I myself would like, but I cannot anticipate anything. Whether, in particular, I would like to understand what extent this collective dynamics, which for me is ubiquitous because it appears very often, is a collective dynamics going to help? Hopefully, or maybe not. Maybe it's just a side effect which is there, but is not important. But so sorry, I cannot give an answer, but I'm sure, I can confirm this is, for me, the most important question.
Yeah, because there is also this idea that the brain could work near a critical point, for instance, one of these transition points where you could get not completely synchronized, but still sensitive or these kind of things.
So, yeah, no, this is a point which is has been debated, is very controversial, and I have not a specific opinion. It sounds, say, attractive, the idea, because you want you don't want to have a very stable dynamics, because otherwise, I mean, you end up always in the same fixed points, and you don't want to have a very chaotic dynamics, because otherwise you forget about the initial value of the computation. In the computation, you want to keep memory of the niche. So it sounds attractive, but eventually transforming this into something which is really convincing, I have never found real compelling evidence of this idea.
Thank you very much.
Okay. So to finish the session, I would like to give the Cecilia, the director of our institute, is going to give some words. So, Cecilia, please.
Yes, thank you so much, Professore Polietti. Thank you very much, grazie, per questo seminario, questo colloquio. And you are welcome to come here and to discuss whatever is a good time. And I'm sorry that I was not before here, I was in another committee, unfortunately. But thank you so much for your colloquium, and I hope to see you soon. And thank you to everyone for being here, and see you later.
I mean, thank you. I repeat, thank you for the invitation, and I also hope that there will be the chance to meet in person, because it's clear that discussing personally is much more effective than just sitting in front of a screen. Okay.
Yes. Yes, it's more. It's better. Okay. Well, thank you to everyone. Gracias a todos. And take care. And okay. Bye bye. Gracias, Gerardo, por todo.
Thank you. Muchas gracias, Cecilia. Thank you very much, Antonio.
Thank you, Gerardo.
Hasta luego a todos.
Thank you all. Bye.
Bien, todos ellos. Hasta luego.
Chao.